just to recognize the fact that this is the beginning of essentially a new era in ministry together. And I am excited about the opportunity to have them in our service and for all of us to join together in the ministry that God has for us in reaching this area. We have a slide. We have a video. Hit the video, please. If you'll notice, there was a lot more Trail Life in that than there was American Heritage Girls. But you can blame Rebecca for that because she's the one who put it all together for us. But it was enjoyable and so much fun to see how much, even from the time that the video was put together, a little over a year ago, I think some of those pictures that they had, that so many of our troop members have grown so much in that time period. It is incredible to see how that has happened. I want to introduce you real quick. If you're a leader in Trail Life for American Heritage Girls, please stand up. There you go. These are the folks who are helping, who are leading the kids, and who are asking for your help in recruiting more and more for the troops. So you will have an opportunity to meet them all after the service this morning. You guys can sit down. If you are either a trailman or an AHG girl, I invite you to stand up this morning. These young men and these young ladies represent an incredible opportunity for the kingdom of God, for this community, for this local church. We are excited to have you here. We are excited to join with you in service and worshiping God together. You can be seated. Thank you so much. If you'd like any more information about American Heritage Girls, they have an information parent meeting this afternoon. If you have a young lady in your life or a neighbor perhaps who has a young lady in her life, they have an informational meeting this afternoon at 3:15 right here, and invite you to come up if you are able to do so. If you'd like some more information regarding American Heritage Girls, that is this afternoon. Saturday afternoon, the Trail Life Troop 4123 has their sailboat derby. That will be right here at the church. As I said last week, it'll be underneath the covered parking at the back. And if you have never seen a sailboat derby, It is a tremendous amount of fun. We had a ball last year and only had one person, or 2 years ago, only had one person pass out, I think, which is great. Apparently, there's been a new implementation of propulsion. I'm going to ask Stanton, is that a good way to say that? Stanton's our engineer, so there you go. Instead of just simply lung power moving those sailboats down the way, there will be a different way of doing this. I'm hoping leaf blower, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes next Saturday. So it'll be fun. I invite you all to come out for that. All right. What else do we have there, Jack? Regular announcements. There you go. Our basket for tithes and offerings is still at the back. I encourage you to remember to drop in your tithe, your offering there. And again, thank you so much for your support during this time. Your continued support for the ministries that our church is involved in. Speaking of which, I want to give you a quick food pantry update. Yesterday, the Shepherd's Heart Food Pantry provided meals for 155 families, and that broke down into 510 individuals and 13 new clients for the food pantry. That is an incredible number, and I continue to thank you all for your prayer support, for your financial support, for your volunteer support. Thank you all so much for all the ways that you continue to support the food pantry. Discipleship study meets on Wednesdays at 7. I know that Pastor Sam isn't going to be here this week, so you'll have to deal with me on Wednesday night. I'm so sorry, but I'll be here Wednesday night, 7 p.m. for our discipleship study. And if you'd like to join by Zoom, that is also available. And just simply look for that link in your email inbox this next week. Back to School Youth Retreat, Labor Day weekend at September 4 through 6, which is right around the corner. That's going to be at Sandy Creek Bible Camp, our place where we generally have our summer youth camp. We are also going to be having the Back to School Youth Retreat there. That's 7th grade through recent high school graduation, I believe, is the grade for that. Normally at this time, I would turn to Cameron and say, Cameron, are there any other announcements? Cameron is not here this morning. There was a wedding up in the Dallas area that she and her family attended last night and apparently didn't get back in time. So if you're watching, Cameron, you have anything that you'd like to say, just go ahead and text it to me. Oh, wait, I don't have my phone on me, so never mind. Don't do that. Thanks again for all of those who continue to take care of our lawn. If you noticed, it rained, and now the lawn needs to be mowed again. So if you're available to mow the grass and continue to maintain the lawn, there's a sign-up sheet there. The lawn mowing team sign-up sheet is on the bulletin board in the foyer. And it's as always, for more information, to view any of the recorded services, you can go to BethelMethodist.com/Robinson. It is good this morning to come into the house of the Lord. It is good this morning to be reminded that we come together with a singular purpose this morning of worshiping God, of recognizing that He is worthy to be worshiped. Our opening song this morning was a song that some of you might have known. Adoration was the name of the song for the prelude this morning, and I appreciate the fact that we started off this morning with a call to adore the Lord. Listen, if you will, to the words the psalmist wrote. Let God arise, and let his enemies be scattered. Let those who hate him flee before him. As smoke is driven away, so drive them away. As wax melts before the fire, let the wicked perish before God. But let the righteous be joyful. Let them exult before God. Let them be jubilant with joy. Sing to God. Sing praises to his name. Lift up a song to him who rides upon the clouds. For his name is the Lord. Exult before him. Father of the fatherless, protector of widows, is God in his holy habitation. God gives the desolate a home to dwell in. He leads out the prisoners to prosperity, but the rebellious dwell in a parched land. Oh God, when did you go forth before your people? When you marched before the wilderness, the earth quaked, the heavens poured down rain at the presence of God. Sinai quaked at the presence of God, the God of Israel. Rain in abundance, O God, you shed upon us. You gave and restored heritage as we languished away. Your flocks found a dwelling in it. In your goodness, O God, did you provide for the needy. Sing to God, O kingdoms of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord, to him who rides in the heavens, the ancient heavens. He sends forth his voice, his mighty voice. Ascribe power to God, whose majesty is over Israel, and his power is in the skies. Terrible is God in his sanctuary, the God of Israel. He gives power and strength to his people. Blessed be God. Let's join together this morning in singing our first song together.
Let's stand together as we sing, Oh, Worship the King.
Worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, brilliant in splendor and girded with praise. Oh, tell of his might, and sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space, his chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light. It streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children of dust and feeble, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end. Our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend. All hail to the King in splendor enthroned. Glad praises we bring, thy wonders make known. Returning victorious, great conqueror of sin, King Jesus, all glorious, our victory to win.
We'll hear from 1 Peter 4:12 through 14 and 5:6 through 11. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal which comes upon you to prove you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may exalt you. Cast all your anxieties upon him, for he cares about you. Be sober, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experience of suffering is required of your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, establish, and strengthen you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Let's sing His Eye is on the Sparrow, hymn number 624.
Mm-hmm. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender words I hear, and resting on His goodness, I lose my doubts and fear. Though by the path He leadeth, but one step I may see, His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free, for His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise. When songs give place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to Him. From care He sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me.
Let's remain standing for the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is sitting at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And from there He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
So I don't know if you know this or not, but on the song His Eye is on the Sparrow, there's actually, you have to turn the page. I'm sorry. The whole chorus is on the next page. Oops. Who knew? Who knew? Who didn't look? That would be me. That would be me. I'm so sorry for that. As we go to prayer this morning, we have, of course, our own needs, the things that we've been praying for, our own praises, the needs within our local body of believers. And we certainly don't want to ignore any of those things. I know we have quite a few folks who are traveling this morning. Some I knew about, I'm looking around, and some I'd forgotten weren't going to be here this morning. So certainly we are in prayer for those who are on the road today, who are traveling. We will be in prayer for those. I did hear from Miss Jerry. Her sister has been on the prayer list for the last several weeks. As her health has slowly declined, Miss Jerry's sister did pass away early this morning, so we'll certainly be in prayer for Miss Jerry and for her family. She said she was not going to be able to attend due to travel issues and due to the fact that where she had to go in Louisiana, the COVID numbers are off the chart. So she said, it's just better for me to stay home and to stay well and to pray for my family from here. So certainly we will join her in that prayer. One of the things we do want to pray for this morning, and something that I want to keep in front of all of us as we go throughout this past week, there are some of you who I know have been praying for issues that are going on around the world, especially in Afghanistan, as we have seen that country just implode and tumble and all of the issues that are going on. One of the things that many folks don't recognize or don't realize is that over the last couple of years, there has been a very strong Christian presence that has been growing at an incredible rate in the country of Afghanistan. Now, those brothers and sisters in Christ find themselves literally fearing for their life. I encourage you, we will be praying for the church in Afghanistan, for others in that nation who are still trying to find a way out, for American citizens who are still trying to find out a way out. But throughout this next week, I encourage you, please be in prayer for our brothers and sisters in Christ in Afghanistan, throughout the world, as we have many places around the world where it's a similar situation, where the Church of Jesus Christ lives right on the edge of society. And those brothers and sisters in Christ plead for us to be in prayer for them, because as we pray, God works in amazing and wonderful ways, and we are so grateful for all the ways that God is able to work in His church. Let us pray. Father, this morning we do indeed lift these needs to You. Lord, You know our hearts. You know that we stand before You, Father, as needy people, needy for so much. Especially needy, Lord God, of Your grace. We stand, Father, as folks who recognize this morning that You are our strength, that You alone are worthy to be called God, that You are the living God. You are not an idea or a concept that was created or invented so that we could have any kind of control over anyone else. Father, You are the living God. You are the God who is active in every part of His creation. You are the God who loves us. You are the God who shows us that love through the cross of Jesus Christ. You are the God who shows us, Lord God, that there is indeed freedom in Christ and joy in Christ and great hope in Christ Jesus. Father, we thank You for this relationship that You are calling us to have with You. Lord, You know the needs that this local body has. You know, Father, the needs that have been brought in here with our visitors this morning. You know, Lord God, the things that weigh heavy on our minds, on our spirits this morning. Father, You invite us to lay all of those needs at Your feet today. As we've heard already in the songs that we've sung, You are aware, Your eye is on that sparrow. You are aware when anything in your creation curse. You are aware, Lord God, of the needs that we have. You are aware, Lord God, of the things that are going on in your world. And we especially lift to you this morning, Lord God, the country of Afghanistan. We pray, Father, not only for that country in a political sense, but, Father, we pray in a spiritual sense that you will be with that church that is in Afghanistan, with those Christian brothers and sisters who are there, who love you, who have said, we would rather lay our lives down for the cause of Jesus than to live any other way. And so, Father, we pray for those brothers and sisters this morning. We ask, Lord God, that you would encourage them. We pray, Father, that you will strengthen them by the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord God. Be that firm foundation in their lives. Lord, guard them. Use their witness, the witness of their lives, in a way that ministers to everyone around them, to their neighbors, to their enemies, that shows them, Lord God, that your way is the only way of salvation, that your way, Lord God, is the only way that we can have peace with you. Thank you, Father, that you are accomplishing this already. Thank you, Lord God, that you are the one who is working, not only for our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan, but for those all around the world who are being persecuted, for us here today, as we bear a different kind of persecution also, as we simply get shoved to the sidelines and say, the church doesn't matter. We'll turn to anything else, but not the church. Today, Lord God, may we proclaim with a loud voice, with boldness, that your way does matter, that there is no better way but the way of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. Hear us now as we join our hearts and our voices together, praying as Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This morning, our scripture reading from the Gospels comes from John chapter 17. This is a passage of scripture that is known as the high priestly prayer. It is the prayer that Jesus prays with his disciples and for his disciples immediately before he is arrested. Listen, if you will, to these words this morning. Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven, and he said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you, as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have glorified you on the earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory with which I had with you before the world was. I have manifested your name to the men whom you gave me, who you have given me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. For I have given to them the words which you have given to me, and they have received them and have known surely that I came forth from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours, and all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now I am no longer in the world, but these are in the world. I come to you. Holy Father, keep them through your name, those whom you have given me, that they may be one as we are one. Stand with me. Let's sing our next hymn together. I am resolved.
Hymn number 566. I am resolved.
no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, these have allured my sight. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greater, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to go to the Savior, leaving my sin and strife. He is the true one, he is the just one, he hath the words of life. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to follow the Savior, faithful and true each day. Heed what he saith, do what he willeth, he is the living way. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to enter the kingdom, leaving the paths of sin. Friends may oppose me, foes may beset me, still I will enter in. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved, and who will go with me? Come, friends, without delay. Taught by the Bible, led by the Spirit, we'll walk the heavenly way. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greater, will come to thee.
Amen. You can be seated.
I have to tell y'all, before the service started, as Andy was playing through the hymns for this morning, he said, oh, I love this song. I love this song. He said, we played it last night at the church where he plays for Saturday Night Church down in Coryell County. And he said, the great thing about this song is that it works really well with a tambourine. He said, do you have a tambourine? And I said, I don't have my tambourine on me this morning, Andy. And he said, man, you need a tambourine. So next time, we'll try to find a tambourine for you, Andy. That'll be fun. I agree. I told him, just have fun. Have fun with it. It's fun singing together and very fun singing those songs like that. We have been talking about poor son is trying to figure out, I can't turn it up. Where is he? I don't have my microphone turned on. We have been talking about the kingdom of God throughout this summer season. It seems like most people enjoy hearing about and talking about the kingdom of God, even though, maybe in spite of, maybe because of, there have been some passages that we've looked at over the course of the summer that have seriously challenged any complacent attitudes that we might have developed or allowed to have developed in our lives. Today, we are talking about the topic of the kingdom of God, but we're adding another topic to this today that very often I find that people don't like talking about nearly as much. And that topic is living as a witness. When most churchgoers, hear preachers talk about witnessing, many just simply stop listening. For the folks who stop listening, the idea has crept into their lives that witnessing is not for me. That's someone else's responsibility, someone who's more educated, someone more outgoing, someone more spiritually mature. That's, preacher, that's just not me, so I'm just going to tune out for a minute. I'll come back in when you're done. The folks who are still listening start to think about ways that they should be sharing their faith more so that their families and their friends and coworkers will be led to make a decision to follow Jesus. That's not wrong, but sometimes there's an issue with that. You see, this line of thinking about doing more usually causes feelings of guilt, as in, I'm not doing enough, or perhaps even stress. How can I take a conversation I'm having with a friend or a family member or a coworker, and how can I turn that conversation toward God in such a way that people don't feel like they're being manipulated, but at the same time, I'm manipulating them into this conversation? How do I do that? You see, I think that both of these ideas carry problems. Both of these ideas that it's not my responsibility and that I have to keep doing more and more and more of this, both of these have problems and I think are erroneous in some ways. As followers of Jesus, we are all, every one of us, no matter our personality type, no matter our level of education, every single one of us are called to be witnesses to the fact of God's power to deliver from sin, to forgive sins, to help and to use us to show the world that God is God. All of us have this same calling upon our lives. And as for any guilt that you might be feeling, that's a result of an attitude that is based more on outward performance than on following God where He leads. Unfortunately, when many preachers talk about witnessing, that focus does tend to be on how we as believers in Jesus are performing as we do the work of witnessing. There are so many books that you can buy, so many pamphlets that talk about this, the right way to lead a conversation, the right way to help somebody come to a better understanding. If you need some pointers, that's not a problem, but when it becomes a how-to kind of thing on sharing our faith, then sometimes problems come up. May God help us realize that there is a difference between doing the act of witnessing and living as a Christian witness. Now, it may sound like the same thing. I had somebody ask me one time, "You must be a preacher." I said, "Well, I am." At the time, I was studying to be a preacher. And I said, "Why do you say that?" And he said, "Because you want to correct everything that I say and say it in a way that sounds exactly like how I just said it, but then you tell me it's not exactly the way that I just said it." I said, "Oh, I didn't realize I was doing that, and I didn't know that was a preacher thing to do." He said, "Oh, yeah, that's a preacher thing to do." Now, it may sound like when I say there's a difference between doing the act of witnessing and living as a Christian witness, it might sound like the same thing, but living as a witness of Jesus Christ is completely different. To do witnessing, only two things are necessary: information and motivation. It doesn't matter if your information is correct or if your motivation is pure. Those are the only two things that you need in order to go out and to do witnessing. We see this in every cult, in every pseudo-Christian organization that exists. While the follower of Christ is called to testify to others about the fact of Jesus, the way that we are to be witnessing is in how we live our daily life. The church is not to use tactics of guilt or shame or coercion in telling others about Jesus, but too often it seems like cult tactics like those have been adopted by the church. Today, I know we said we were going to talk about the kingdom of God, and we've only been talking about witnessing. Today, we conclude our summer series on the kingdom of God. We are doing so by taking a look at Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 8. Since this is the passage that brings to an end Jesus' earthly time with his disciples, it seems like a good choice for us to read. So let's read it, starting in verse 6. Therefore. Hey, wanted to make sure I got that one in there. Therefore, When they had come together, they asked Jesus, saying, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" And he said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth." There are two things that we have to notice in this passage this morning. The first, the question that is asked by the disciples. The second, the answer that is given by Jesus. We like to make fun of the disciples. There it is. We like to make fun of the disciples and the question that they ask Jesus. After all, how, after all this time and after all they have seen, can these disciples still be asking the wrong question? But think about this. Jesus' resurrection from the dead has shown that he has conquered death. Jesus' followers do not need to fear death because it has no power to separate them from God. Jesus' death was the sacrifice that would satisfy God's justice. Now, a relationship between God and humanity can be restored by the forgiveness of sins through Jesus. In the minds of the disciples, everything that God has done through Jesus in his life and in Jesus' death has completed God's purpose to redeem creation and to conquer the kingdom of this world. There must be only one thing left. God is ready to establish God's kingdom on earth. And the popular way of thinking for the disciples meant that God will make Israel the ruling power over all the other kingdoms of the world. We've heard in weeks past that the idea of the word translated as kingdom throughout the New Testament can be understood differently in our culture than how the disciples probably understood the word in their culture. For us, the word kingdom usually carries the idea of a realm, the kingdom of Great Britain, for example. There's a king at the top, or a queen in the case of Britain. There's a ruler, someone who is in royal power over everyone else, and that person lords that power over everyone else and tells them what to do. Everyone wants to be king. Everyone wants to be queen, right? Can you imagine what a mess that would be? What a mess. But in New Testament times, the Greek word that we have didn't just refer to a king or a queen or a nation, a political power. It referred to the very right to rule. It was the sovereign authority of the one in power. And so when we talk about the kingdom of God here that these disciples are talking about, these folks understood that it is God who has the right and the authority to properly rule. And that right, that sovereignty, has been shown in all that God has done through Jesus. This understanding of kingdom would put the earthly church in a constant struggle with the Roman civil authority. The disciples were ready for God to rightly rule over all the world. Who wouldn't be? For too long, Rome had claimed the right to rule. Before Rome, it was the Greeks. Before them, the Persians. And as we saw last week in the book of Daniel, that just kept going on and on. One kingdom after another, and they would all fall. Each of these worldly powers showed that human political power serves self, it redefines justice, and it brings about corruption. The disciples are tired of all of this. It's time for God to rule. Of course, we understand the sentiment of the disciples. If anything, human government and human politics has continued down the same path the Romans were on over 20 centuries ago. We today are tired of politics, policies, and programs that are guided by self-focused, unjust, and sinful leaders. We are ready for God's kingdom to come as well. Remember Elijah's response to the clash of earthly kingdoms with God's right to rule? We talked about this just a couple of weeks ago. For those of you who weren't here, you're off the hook. For everybody else, we were there. We talked about it. Elijah became so tired of waiting for God's kingdom to overthrow the kingdom that was led by Jezebel and Ahab that Elijah was ready to just simply walk away from God's call. In fact, he was ready to walk away from life itself. He laid down underneath that juniper tree. And he said, God, let me die. Let me die. I'm tired of this. I'm tired of seeing all of this stuff that goes against what you say is right. Sometimes we feel the despair that Elijah felt as we look at the world around us. Sometimes I feel like we want to cry out like the martyrs cried out there in Revelation chapter 6. How long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge? We could ask that question another way, and we often do. The question of when. When, Jesus, will the kingdom come to this earth? How long must we wait? This tendency to despair makes it even more important for us to hear Jesus' answer in the second part of this passage. Jesus plainly tells his disciples in verse 8, you shall be witnesses to, or witnesses of me to the world. I think there's a right answer, Jack. There it is. You shall be witnesses to or of me. When I read these words, I know that there's some of you who are already getting those old feelings of guilt. Oh, I have to be doing more than I'm already doing. This is not a message that's supposed to make you feel guilty. Let's do away with the idea of doing witnessing, and let's take a closer look at this word that's translated as witnesses. The Greek word that Jesus uses for witness is martus, the word from which our language gets the word martyr. That's right. The same word for witness is also the word for martyr. It puts a little different spin on that Revelation verse, doesn't it? We seldom think of witness when we think of martyr. The description that springs to mind is probably a fanatic. That's what we think of when we think of martyrs. After all, who would take such a radical stand as being willing to die for what they believe? At the heart of Jesus' answer is the idea that the work of God has not concluded with Jesus' death, with his resurrection, and with his ascension. Instead, the work is only beginning. We need to hear Jesus' right answer as much as the disciples needed to hear it. The disciples' question comes from a place of being ready to come to the end of the journey. We've come so far with you over these last 3 years, Jesus. Now, it's time for us to just simply sit back and relax and watch what happens. Jesus says, no. The same way that's what happened with Elijah. God said to Elijah, no. You don't get to stay here in this cave. No, you don't get to lay down under this juniper tree and die. I have a task for you. Go! That's constantly what we hear. Go, you, go. But go in a right way. God is giving us the direction in which God is directing us to move. We are not to remain sitting in our pews waiting to die and go to heaven any more than the disciples were to remain in Jerusalem after the descent of the Holy Spirit upon their lives. The Holy Spirit empowered and equipped these everyday people, these blue-collar workers, these disciples, these fishermen from Galilee, to be witnesses with their lives to the fact of God's activity in the world through Jesus. And we, brothers and sisters, are given the same Spirit, the same gifts, the same direction that the first followers received from Jesus. So what's the takeaway idea from this passage this morning? Let's sum it up by saying that the kingdom of God will come in fullness and power, and that the evidence of God's kingdom is seen in the life of every follower of Jesus. We may wonder what else God needs to do before God's kingdom is revealed. But the question of timing remains in God's hands, where it belongs. He is, after all, the sovereign with the right to rule. We must trust God with God's timing. Instead of speculation or argument among ourselves, we need to constantly hear Jesus' answer, go! And be witnesses to the world with your lives. Witnesses of God's power to destroy the bondage of sin. To deliver.
to heal, to bring hope and wholeness. In the book, The Gospel of the Kingdom, George E. Ladd comes to the conclusion that the ultimate meaning of history between the ascension of Jesus and his return in glory is found in the extension and the working of the gospel in the world. That's what he's talking about, is right now. Between the ascension of Jesus and the time in which Jesus comes back. That's right now. That's right. That's where we are. The ultimate meaning of history is found in the extension and the working of the gospel in the world. In other words, God has entrusted to the church, of which we are a part through faith in Jesus, the responsibility of sharing with others the good news of God's power to redeem and to save from the power of sin. This task cannot be accomplished in our own strength any more than we can provide for our own redemption or our own salvation. God's instruction to go and to share can only be accomplished as we choose every day to live in the power of God's grace. The choice to follow Jesus carries a commitment to live a life of resolute and radical obedience to God. This commitment is made possible by the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit brought into our lives at conversion. There are powerful foes at work in the world trying to distract from or to destroy the news of God's victory through the cross of Jesus. But we have no need to fear those foes. Through the Holy Spirit, God's power goes with us. Through Jesus, God has accomplished the greatest act of emancipation the world has ever seen. If we have experienced this freedom in Christ from the power of sin in our own lives, then we must go, for the world needs to hear this good news that we have to share with them. This morning I invite you, as we sing our final hymn together, I invite you, where you're standing this morning, instead of coming to these altars and kneeling and praying, if God's laid something on your heart, I invite you this morning, as we're standing, as we're singing, to simply, as you're singing, bow your head and to pray and say, God, how is it? How is it that I can live my life, best live my life as a witness for you? God, where is it that you are calling me to? God, help me to live in the power of your Holy Spirit, in the power of your forgiveness, and in the power of your grace as we go and take this message to the world. Let's sing.
Let's stand together. We'll sing 377. Alleluia, sing to Jesus.
Alleluia, sing to Jesus. Is the scepter, is the throne. Alleluia, is the triumph. Hear the sound.
Amen.
I don't know if you noticed, but we sang that song last Sunday also. There was a part in there where it said, thunders forth, and you might have remembered last Sunday there was this boom. Man, it was fun preaching that message last week in the middle of a thunderstorm. That was good. Let us pray. Father God, this morning you have brought us to this place. Lord God, you have taught us through the scriptures. You have encouraged us through the presence of your Holy Spirit. You have given us a new song to sing in our hearts and in our minds throughout the rest of this week. And that new song, Lord God, is a song of testimony, a song of witness, a song, Lord God, in which it's not just our words that we give to you, it's our lives. Lord God, you take our lives, little as they might seem, and you take that and you work through each of us who are willing, through each of us who are surrendered to you. And you work through our lives, Lord God, to bring about a testimony of the fact that you alone are God. Father, thank you that you have called us to go and to live this message in the world today. Now, Father, we go in that power. We go in the presence of your Holy Spirit. We go with this message. We go with this new song. We go with this encouragement and with this hope, because we look around us, Lord God, and recognize that you are sending us out like sheep into the midst of wolves. We go, Father, and recognize that you are sending us out like points of light into the darkness of this world. But Father, we go knowing that you alone are the sovereign one who is able to work, who is able to heal, who is able to save. Thank you, Father, for a message to share with those around us. Thank you, Lord God, for the power that you give through Jesus. Amen.
Down at your feet, and any time.